Hello everyone, I'm Ron Vale, and I would like to welcome everyone to today's Google Hangout, which I think should be quite lively and interesting. And we have a great pleasure to have my good friend and colleague, Keith Yamamoto, here. So Keith, thanks for joining us.
Sure, it's great to be here, Ron.
So we have a bunch of questions already in. I do want to tell the audience that you can, on your right side, post a question live. You can also vote on existing questions. And we'll try to select questions that are also voted highly, but also select a diversity of different types of questions as well. So I just want to start off with a few words of introduction about Keith. So Keith grew up in the heartland in Des Moines and went to Iowa State. He then was a graduate student, actually, with our prior Google Hangout speaker, Bruce Alberts, and then came to do a postdoc with Gordon Tompkins at UCSF. And in that work, he was introduced to steroid receptors, which has been the topic of his research ever since. He then started as an assistant professor at UCSF. He's been here ever since. He's really was kind of at the start of the really great development of science at UCSF. He then was chair of the Cellular Molecular Pharmacology Department for about 10 years and really transformed that department in many important ways, particularly with an emphasis on chemical biology. He's now the Vice Chancellor for Research and Executive Vice Dean for the School of Medicine. And beyond all that, an amazing scientist who is a member of the National Academy of Sciences. He's done really pioneering work on understanding how glucocorticoid work, particularly at the level of controlling gene transcription. Particularly fascinating topic is that these same hormones produce different effects in different cells and tissues, and Keith has really done beautiful work over the years in defining how glucocorticoid produce these effects, which shed light not only on the physiology of the hormones, but on transcription in general. So also what distinguishes Keith is, in addition to being a fantastic scientist, he's really been a leader, a thoughtful leader of the scientific community, and has invested just an enormous amount of his time, really at the national level, just for the betterment of all of us, to create a better and greater scientific community. So, for example, he's currently chairing the Coalition of Life Sciences, which is a group, collective group of several professional societies, to explain science, the importance of science to government and for science funding. He's been doing that since 1993. He's chairman of the board of life sciences at the National Academy. He's also been heavily involved with the review process for grants. He has chaired several committees in scientific review. And again, he's just an extremely thoughtful individual who's really thinking ahead on how to make the practice of science better. And today's topic is certainly a really interesting and important one, one that we've already touched on a bit with Greg Petsko's Google Hangout and also with Bruce Alberts, but it's how we think about training our young scientists. And Keith talked about this in his iBioMagazine piece, which if you haven't seen, I assume many of you have, but please go and have a look at that. But the topic is how we can rethink graduate education. Basically, we've been training people the same way for 50 years plus. Is it time for some new ideas? So Keith has some lively discussions on that point, and well, enough said. Thank you for joining us, Keith.
Sure.
Let me just start off, just get the ball rolling, and I'm just going to read questions and you do the talking. But our first one is from Melissa. That question is, what role should students PhD advisors have in helping prepare them for diverse job opportunities? What responsibility should PIs have for familiarizing themselves with career routes and helping steer students in those directions?
Good question, and I think that it bears on an important point, and that is that the proposal that I made, and I think the responsibility that we have in familiarizing students with their career, the range of career options, does not extend, in my view, to PhD advisors themselves becoming sufficiently familiar to make those broad spectrum of cases to students. I think instead it should be the graduate programs that do this, find ways to make contacts to the outside world, to the community of business people and lawyers and educators and communicators and policy people where students can establish contacts with them either through mentorships or through informed conversations, so they can become familiar in that way. So then it would fall to the faculty member, and in particular the student's advisor, to be supportive of this, to recognize that the world has changed from the time that certainly that I was training as a PhD student, when it was really a linear pathway that went from the first day in graduate school to becoming an assistant professor. Now it's clearly a branched one, and I think it really falls to the faculty to recognize that, acknowledge it, support it, and make clear to students that that array of options is out there, and that the graduate programs are going to make available to students sufficient information to allow students to make informed choices with confidence on the day they get their PhD.
Just to follow that up a bit, what are some good examples of places that you think are doing that well, or particular programs that are doing that well?
Right. So UCSF has begun a series of programs that I think are trying to move in this direction. I was on the NIH Workforce Committee, and one of the recommendations that came out of that was that the NIH should actually generate a funding mechanism to support institutions who want to invent ways to be able to do this, to familiarize students well with the range of career options. That grant is called the BEST Award. The first 10 of those have been awarded, and UCSF was fortunate to get one of those as well. So there's a couple of programs that are ongoing here and at 10 institutions around the country. The next round of those applications is coming up, and so I'm sure that I know that another set of institutions will be awarded. So there's an experiment underway nationwide for institutions to begin to invent these in their own environments, things that they think will be particularly well suited to that institution and the students within it, that I think will hopefully identify some best practices that will allow us to really get started on this.
Okay. Well, I'll take another one, actually, it just because it was voted up from Alyssa, but it has the most votes right now. What advice do you have for students to effectively work with their advisors to negotiate time for career exploration? So it's kind of related to the last question.
It is. And it's important. Another important question. I think that, so this is really a question of what advice do I have for students to negotiate this with faculty. So on the one hand, I would hope, you know, in the ideal world, there wouldn't be a need for that negotiation. There would be support from the faculty, and I know that there are faculty that are very supportive of this and can be helpful. That's not true across the board. This is the real world, and Melissa's question is from the real world. And it is something that we need to recognize. And in a way, it's really a question of two levels. One is the kind of on the ground level that Melissa refers to, and that is that what do I do if my faculty advisor is not supportive of this whole idea? Who really feels that you're in graduate school, you should be at the bench working, and you can worry about this other stuff later, or the other stuff is not important or not valid even. What do we do about that? And I guess my advice would be to go to other faculty members in your institution who do feel this way or like-minded with you, and get their advice. It's going to be something where it's going to have to be, we'll need a local solution. So if you feel that you can't work with your advisor on this, then talk to other faculty members who might be supportive and might be helpful. The negotiation is a real one, of course, real for you and real for the advisor. Your work is going to be at a certain place. It will progress in a certain way. Your advisor may feel that it's time to write a paper or to get ready for a talk, and that this isn't the right moment to step out. And I think sitting down and saying, okay, what would be a good time? In the program that we have here, called Graduate Student Internships for Career Exploration, one of the programs that we have at UCSF. That program allows for a 10-week period in which a student, after finishing their orals, advancing to candidacy, can step out, go off campus for 10 weeks, and spend time in another career sector. What our program has done is to permit those internships to begin anytime, as I said, after advancing to candidacy, after finishing orals, up until immediately after having the degree actually awarded. So there's a fair amount of time in there, and I think that a negotiation with an advisor to find that time to get acknowledgement that this is something that's of interest to the student, and to work together with the faculty member to find a block of time. It might be something that faculty would feel actually is worthwhile and that their interests are being considered by the student along with the student's interests.
Well, this is a very closely related question, but it's from one of our own graduate students. From Sally, who says, my impression as an upper-year UCSF grad student is that many PIs aren't supportive of their students looking into alternative careers, simply assuming they want to be PIs. Can UCSF train? I guess the question is there actually some training that is required for PIs to be supportive and, I suppose, also more knowledgeable about other kinds of careers other than their own?
Right. So again, this bears on the problem that many of the faculty members, including those at UCSF, have trained in this linear pathway, and the world has changed. And so in that sense, the faculty need to become familiar themselves with what that array of options is. They don't have to be sufficiently expert in each of the areas so that they feel like they're going to go march off with their own careers. But I think that in recognizing the world that is facing their trainees, this is an important thing to do. So I think there is a responsibility of the programs as they develop within institutions to begin to educate the faculty, literally to change the culture. We are in a situation where there are many faculty who still view these careers as Sally says in her question, as alternatives, and the sort of stigma that's attached to that is that it's an alternative to the real thing. That if you come out of your PhD training looking like me, and you become another faculty member, then that's great, and anything else is an alternative. And I think we need to begin to change that as well. I think that can be done as programs begin to succeed, as students find that these new training options that we're putting in place to familiarize students with these careers, if they find them to be useful and successful, they will be happier, they will be motivated to finish their PhD work and move on to these other areas. It's always easier to drive forward and complete something if you know what's coming at the other end. When you don't, and it's just undetermined or feeling that there's really nothing out there for me, then it's harder to finish up. So I think that if these programs succeed, we will have a happier cohort of students, those that feel that the programs are really supporting them and recognizing their needs, and faculty will recognize that and themselves become more supportive. So that's an important part of changing culture as well.
Okay, well, this is, I guess, another related... I think we clicked on the wrong question. But as a prelude, I think this is another question related to, scientific culture and also what we reward. So obviously what is rewarded for sure is research and research output. But what you're talking about also is mentorship and establishing the right culture of mentorship. And so the question is, this came in by email, but although mentorship is a big component of science education, good mentorship is rarely rewarded, and bad mentorship is never detrimental. There's no negative points for that in the career structure, especially in faculty. So how can institutions evaluate mentorship and mentorship interactions, maybe to extrapolate upon that, maybe include it as a bigger component of the reward system?
Yeah, I think that's an important thing to do. I think the questioner here is making an important point, and that is that mentorship is important, really crucial as it is in our endeavor, is not something that is commonly at least perceived as being rewarded. This is despite the fact that that successful scientists almost always, perhaps it would be fair to say always, have benefited from great mentorship, often throughout their careers. I certainly feel that way for myself. And Bruce Alberts, when I started with him, was an assistant professor with one student in his lab at Princeton, and I felt that he was really incredibly supportive and helpful to me, and remains so. So we all need mentors all the way through our careers, and yet this isn't recognized in ways that the reward structure is formally set up that way. I would like to see there be much more transparency for the performance of professors in this mentoring role. Why not have on every institutional website the record of the outcomes of trainees from every laboratory? And so as a straight, pure, objective measure, I can imagine there could be qualitative measures as well, comments from trainees and things of that sort. But I think the more valuable thing would be just to have an objective record. This would be something that the institution would stand for, as well as individual faculty members, and that could be quite helpful.
Okay, this is from Michael. Rather than currently pushing them away from the science path, PhD postdocs, shouldn't we try to help them better understand their skills and knowledge that could be useful to industry? Maybe have the PI work with them on that.
I'm not sure I understand the question. Yeah, let me look in.
How can you best, students or postdocs be, I think, made aware of their strengths? And kind of direct them towards those strengths,
mm-hmm.
That might actually, I guess, guide them in a way, to a good career path that's really well suited for their talents.
Right. Okay, great. Great question. One of the recommendations that came out of the NIH Workforce Committee was a much more extensive use of the IDP, Individual Development Plan. This is a report annually that, where the advisor and the student and the trainees sit down together and go through not a performance review, but sort of an, a career interest review. This IDP plan has been around for some time in a general career sense, but has been reworked, engineered to be specific to trainees in the biomedical sciences. And so that is available on the NIH website and is something that could be quite useful. We actually wanted the recommendation to say that trainees with any kind of NIH support would use this IDP every year. The recommendation was a good deal softer than that, but I think it really is useful for students to have a look at that. Defining your own interests is not always that easy because we only come in with a limited range of knowledge and expertise. We tend to like what you've already been doing, but that doesn't mean that if you could look more broadly or think about your general interests in a broader, more general way, that things might change substantially. And the IDP is designed to identify those interests.
Okay, I'm going to ask a question from John Leonard, which I think is, which is that one? Okay, I'll ask this one. Go ahead. So I think this is really, this is from Natalia. I think it's at the core of your talk on iBiology, which is, could you elaborate on how your idea of the PhD hub changes the role and nature of the academic postdoc?
Sure.
Important to follow up on that, too.
Okay. That's an important question, Natalia. So those who saw the talk saw that I had a diagram that showed that the current situation is that students go into PhD training. They may become aware during that time that there's a big spectrum of things out there that they could do, but they don't become sufficiently familiarized with them that they could make a decision at the PhD level. And so in many cases, the choice to go to a postdoc is a default choice. We get into postdoc situations. Those of you who are postdocs know that that can be an even more isolating endeavor than graduate school. The institutions tend not to pay a lot of attention to postdocs and so forth. They think that you've gone to work with an individual professor, and good for you, and have a nice time while you're here, but we don't have any responsibilities for you. The postdocs go through this period. They're still undifferentiated, still aware that there are options, but still not getting familiarized with them. And the result of that can be doing another postdoc. And so the proposal, specifically the PhD Hub proposal, was to move that whole spectrum of opportunities back to the PhD, give PhDs sufficient familiarization that they can choose a track. And one of those tracks would be to become an academic or industry principal investigator, PI. And that track would be called a postdoc. And so now you can see that there actually would become a specific educational responsibility that would fall to institutions, in my view, as well as mentors, for the postdocs if that world were to come about. Because finally, those postdocs would be differentiated. They would be the people that have self-identified as wanting to go on to become principal investigators. And then there would be a training obligation, responsibility, on the part of both the mentor and the institution, in my view, to familiarize those trainees with what it means and what it would take to become an effective principal investigator. That means not only understanding lab management and people management skills, which are important and considerable, but balancing the various tasks, workload that come with assuming those responsibilities, and of course the really critical thing of being able to plan an independent research program. I think truth be told, we don't really become trained to be independent investigators during graduate school. This is meant to be a period of mentored research. That's how you choose the laboratory that you go to, that you like the program that the professor has underway. You insert yourself into that program, make contribution, hopefully a really exciting one, but a contribution within the framework of that program. But it's not really your invention. And the postdoc would then have this, the postdoc period would then come with this responsibility to train you to be able to do that. It's a tricky business, training to become independent, if you think about it. But I think it's something that we need to recognize and take on as a responsibility.
Yeah, so I have a couple of follow-up questions on that, too. One of which is, if we shift things more to the PhD hub, how do we know how many jobs await those graduates at that level? I mean, how can we assess, quote-unquote, the job market for a recently minted PhD? And the second, which is a related question, is how do you get a cooperative shift from the postdoc holding tank to a PhD hub, in the sense that if there are people competing for jobs and employers are looking at people that have a postdoc, whether they need it or not, whether they need that postdoc or not for that particular training, they still come with additional training on their CV. So, you know, the question here is that, you know, at the workforce level, how do we know how many jobs there are for the PhDs, and or kind of shift the system so that those jobs become more available?
Right. So those are two big questions, Ron, and important ones. Let me try to take them in order, although likely I'll forget the second one by the time I finish the first. The first one is really key, and that is, how do we know how many jobs are needed? I have been concerned about a fairly extensive cohort of policymakers and investigators who simply make a declaration that we're training too many people. I think that we don't know the answer to that question, important question yet. And the reason is that our field is so dynamic. Things are changing at a rapid pace. We are in what many people have called the century of biology. That is a long period of time in which biological principles and findings and approaches and technologies can be used not only to just advance knowledge in the kind of ivory tower intellectual sense, but to actually apply to and address burning issues in our society. There's a report from the National Academies that was published in 2009 that made this case called the New Biology, and made the assertion, strong assertion, that the big problems in our societies, and they picked out, this committee picked out four: health, environment, energy, and food and agriculture. In each of those cases, there are challenges that we're facing for which we don't have solutions. In the next 30 years, we need to double food production in this world to feed the anticipated growth in the population. There are no ways for us to be able to do that. And the ways that people might imagine would be so determined: land use, water use, putting fertilizer into the environment, that they would destroy health and so forth. These are an integrated set of huge problems. And this report holds that the way that biological and biomedical research is moving can actually begin to approach those problems in real time ways. If this is true, then I would contend that we don't know what the demand for workload will be across the spectrum of career options that we already know about, to say nothing of those that would emerge as these as we began to attack these problems. So I think that we really don't know right now what the call will be for those with PhD training in the life sciences in the future. And this is not the right time to be pulling back. So I would answer your question in the following general way, and that is that I think that if we do our job right, if we do familiarize people during their PhD training with these career options and advance them, let them be develop dynamically as the world changes and adopts the use of biological principles. Then the students themselves will kind of adjust and move out into these areas. The world will become familiar with with people of this kind of training and thinking, being able to take on these problems, and the demand will then get set by the way the societal impact that these people have. And so I think the students themselves can begin to define the answer to that question, and they will actually drive it in ways that are effective. So I think it's too early for us to simply make a declaration that we're training too many people. Your second question is much more in the present, and that is that if we were able to pull back and define a PhD hub, then what would happen in terms of who would be employed? There would be a set of postdocs out there, people with postdoc training, expertise, CVs that are looking for jobs. And then suddenly there would be a cohort of PhDs who are familiar with the job opportunities. And who's going to get the jobs first? I don't really know the answer to that. I think that it will be a mix of people that are perceived by employers as having kind of the immediate skill set and talents that are available. If the PhD programs adjust in such a way that there's rather widespread use of internships, for example, at the PhD level, I think those people are going to compete extremely well.
So this is a bit of a follow-up question from Jessica. And the question is, in your view, should the number of postdoc positions be capped, and if so, by what mechanism?
So again, I wouldn't insert artificial caps. We don't know enough right now to be able to do that. So I would hesitate any kind of artificial, what I would term to be artificial caps to be put in. I think that if we were to move to this PhD hub idea, then again, the trainees themselves would be the determinants of the number of trainees that would move into the postdoc area. I think I should emphasize especially for those who may not have seen the iBio presentation, that this PhD hub idea would actually greatly reduce the number of postdocs that the trainees would diversify at the PhD level out into these various career options, and only one of them would actually be a postdoc. So the world of academic labs, what they would look like, would change substantially. And the number of postdocs would go down. It would be defined, at least in my view, by the people who choose to go in that direction.
Okay, finally, I'm going to get to John Leonard here. John asks, even in places this is a cultural perception question, even in places that seem to encourage non-academic careers, many faculty assume that, quote-unquote, the best students will become professors, and the, quote-unquote, alternative careers are those reserved for those less skilled. What is your take on this, and what can we do to combat it?
Yeah, important question, John. This is really the culture change question, and how we begin to move away from this mentality of alternative careers. We've tried to ban the use of that term around here at UCSF, but simply banning it is not going to make it change. Hopefully, it'll just raise a little bit of consciousness, which is useful. I think that making any big changes like this in society, the solutions that I turn to is to operate, to do small-scale experiments at a scale that is sufficient to be noticed and have an impact, but small enough that there are enough variables that are under your control that this experiment can actually work. I think that we are fortunate in a place like UCSF where there is a good, strong cohort of both faculty and trainees that feel that this is an important direction for us to go. But Ron would probably be, and I would be among the first to acknowledge that even here, that there's a long way to go. And so there are no successful experiments out there that we can simply point to and say, act like that. And I think it's up to us to begin to become those standard bearers. I would argue that any one institution or part of an institution that would engage in an experiment and begin to see that experiment worked. The students are happier, they are moving in a more directed way, they feel that the program is supportive and recognizing the real world and providing the information that they need, that they will finish their work more briskly, be happier during the time that they're doing it and after they leave, and those programs will be noticed and will be increasingly successful. Other places will have to respond to that, whether it's the rest of the institution that we're talking about or other competing institutions. They'll notice it because students will notice it and will have to respond. Hopefully things can begin to move in that way.
Okay, I will ask a question from Amitabha. Are, as U.S. biological sciences enters a time where scientists' career livelihood is not guaranteed, even after years of hard work, what do you think is the likelihood that bright young people taking up scientific research as a career?
Well, you know, it's a great question, and I think that I think that the opportunities, the problems that are out in front of us, the opportunities for us to be able to take on difficult questions and answer big, exciting issues that move knowledge forward and have real impact in society have never been stronger. We have not been as good at communicating that or conveying the excitement, continued excitement, of that kind of discovery as we might be as a community. But I think that the strength of the endeavor, the profession, the attractiveness of the profession has never been stronger. So it's up to us to be able to convey that to the outside community, to trainees that are looking what to see whether they want to try to move forward in their training in this field, and it's really up to us to be able to do that. It's not because there's been some erosion of the interesting questions that are available, quite the opposite. So it's really up to us to convey that to the outside community, and then to craft training programs that are effective in being able to move students through the training period. The training periods are too long. There's a perception there's really nothing at the end of the road. We're talking about exactly that, that there's a lot at the end of the road, but we're not familiarizing students with it. And if we can make those corrections, then I think that the endeavor will continue to be very robust. You're making a good point, and that is that it's a challenge to those of us who are involved in enunciating what the career is about and providing for changes in the training program so that people feel more supported and optimistic as they move through it.
So this is a question related to kind of strategies for training in the life sciences, and also I think it's an interesting international question because different countries approach this in different ways. So this is a question from Shankar. What would be a better option for finishing undergraduate, a direct PhD or an MS degree followed by a PhD? And again, one could take this at a broader perspective because it's rarer in the U.S. to have like a really meaningful master's program, but that's kind of a common branch point in other countries, India and Europe and other places around the world where they're actually is more of a formal master's plus PhD element?
Yeah, I think it's, I think it's a good question in the context we've just been discussing, and that is, it's a changing world. While it's true, Ron, that this is not as familiar in the U.S. As it is elsewhere, one way to think about the question is whether there would be advantages moving back toward having kind of a formal stop point, I don't mean that as an end point, but a formal master's position on the way to the PhD that we don't really have in many places within the U.S. Some places do, but many places do not. And given this hub idea, one could argue that we need to front load this familiarization of career options in graduate school so that students can, as they become familiar, could actually branch out of the PhD at the master's level and say, I want to go for a career in which, in fact, the PhD training, my PhD training, is not really something that's important for the career or for the level that I want to be able to operate at. It's fine that other people want to go ahead and get a PhD and then move into those careers. I don't have any problem with that, but for my interests and my skills, I think that the master's will be sufficient. If we could front load that familiarization with career options into the first couple of years, it's not the way that we've designed the program here at UCSF because we don't have that master's stop, then it would open up that chance for people to branch out even at the master's level. I think that's an interesting idea, an interesting thought, something that might be well taken up in countries where the master's is common, in institutions within the U.S. where the master's is a more of a formalized endpoint, and let experiments move on at that level and see if it's something that we want to spread more widely.
Okay, I'll now ask a question that's been voted up to the top here by Sally. It seems that many, I will use quote-unquote alternative careers, that get publicized don't require or need a PhD. K-12 education, IP law, business, etc., all have different training tracks to arrive at those careers, master's in education, JD, MBA, etc. Why get a PhD to go into these careers?
Mm-hmm. So, great question. So, maybe the way to start is to say that it's certainly the case that the current view of those careers does not require PhD training in the life sciences. That the people who occupy those careers at present, in general, don't have PhD training in life sciences, so it would represent a real change. But I think we are talking about change here. I think what we're arguing is that we are at a stage in our development as a profession where the opportunities to have a broader impact other than driving knowledge forward but have an impact out in society have never been greater. At a much broader level, what is also the case is that in the future, our society is increasingly going to have to make big decisions that are based, that have at their heart complex technologies that for which there's not general public expertise and also not an expertise of those who represent us, whether it is in Congress or in these various professions. And so with that facing us, I think the argument is that increasingly we will need within all of these other professions a cohort, a subset of lawyers and educators and communicators and policymakers and so forth. That have gone through PhD training, that have taken on the challenge of being able to think about a complex biological question, think about an approach to being able to answer that question, been through the rigorous kind of training of discovery as a way of thinking, and then move into these other areas with that knowledge really deeply set, and that it will change the way that they carry out the rest of their careers. So it doesn't have to be everybody, but I think what we're suggesting is that there is a need for that cohort. What we're finding in our internship program here at UCSF is quite interesting in this regard, and that is that I think that it's fair to say that at least some of the sponsors of these internships out in the public and private sector outside of academia took on the offer to host interns kind of as a service at UCSF. They said, "Oh yeah, UCSF is great, and you want to do this, and so yeah, we'll have somebody come and visit us for 10 weeks." What they're finding is that they are very excited about the kinds of people or their students who go do these 10-week internships. Multiple interns have gotten job offers during their internship to stay at these places, and they are finding that these students have a way of thinking about problems, have a way of working, of operating within the world that is really valuable to them. I think that cohort would grow, and the professions themselves would change in positive ways as we move forward.
Okay, I'll ask a question from Veronica. Career exploration in the biological sciences may benefit from students engaging in peer mentoring. Would you agree? How can graduate programs tap into this type of resource?
Here at UCSF, we have a number of diverse PhD programs that accept students with very different backgrounds, that come in with very different backgrounds. Just adapting to the new opportunities, increasingly we have students who aren't trained traditionally in biology that come in with undergraduate degrees in physics and chemistry and engineering and computer science and so forth, and don't have a grounding, sometimes at all, in the biological sciences. At least one of our big training programs here, called the Integrated Program in Quantitative Biology, has taken on an approach that is very useful in the context of your question, Veronica. And that is that at day one, when they arrive and move into a series of boot camps that are designed to bring all of our first year students to a level of general literacy across the spectrum of things that they're going to be learning and experiencing during graduate school, the students are divided into teams of, I don't know, four or five people, I'm not sure what the number is. In which the teams are designed to be populated with students entering UCSF with very different backgrounds. And then they move into the computer science, computer training boot camp, and there's someone on the team that is a computer scientist. And there is a molecular biologist on the team who's not a computer scientist, doesn't know the tricks of the trade, and they begin teaching each other from day one. They move through the boot camps. There's always somebody on the team who's an expert, and there's usually somebody on the team who doesn't know very much, and they begin teaching each other right away. I think that kind of familiarity with peer mentoring is really valuable. Adopting this spirit and seeing the advantages of working in teams is really important. It's really the way that many of us think the best research is going to be done going forward. And I think that's one approach that can really be effective.
Well, maybe I'll just have one follow-up question on both Sally and Veronica's question, but that is ways of working with other professions to facilitate, you know, these transitions into other careers. You know, I think what happens is all of our professions are very siloed. You know, the educational community does have their own system for training K through 12 teachers, and it's not always very easy for a recently minted PhD to fit in that mold. They have to start all over, get a teaching certificate, etc. Are there kind of strategic higher level strategies actually to, instead of sending our PhDs out in the world to find a job, actually work strategically long term to kind of integrate paths where also the people that graduate with a PhD can also get the certification that they need to get into that other occupation?
Well, I hope so. I mean, how much that's available to us now is not clear. There's a certain, at least in the private sector, in biotech and pharma, we hear that the students that are coming in out of academic training don't always have the kind of training that allows them to step right into even just doing continuing to do research in that sphere, much less these other options that you're talking about, Ron. And so that the perception is that further training is needed no matter what. That may be the case, but your question of whether something can be done to allow them to not have to step back to day one for training and education, for example, or step back to day one for going to law school, whether it's something that can be done to allow them to kind of enter at a different level. I think it's an interesting question. As you know, there are training programs in medicine that permit that to happen, that fast track it. A PhD coming in can fast track to an MD in 2 years. There's several programs like that around the country. And so there's a profession that has recognized that people with PhD training have already a set of skills that are useful. If we can succeed in beginning to populate these other careers with people with PhD training in biomedical sciences or biological sciences, then I think that those professions too would begin to adopt and find ways to short track some of these people. It's early days, we'll see what can happen, but at least there are a couple of examples out there of ways that can be done.
Okay, this one? This one, a lot of people are interested in this question too. In order to promote the idea of a PhD hub, should PhD programs invite representatives from other careers into their training? An editor as an instructor for a series of courses on scientific writing and editing, or a law professor teaching patent law?
I'm a little bit, you can tell from my hesitation, I'm a little bit torn about how to answer this question well. I guess I would have to start by saying that it's at least my opinion that there is no obligation, or in my view even an advantage, in graduate programs in the biological science, in the life sciences, trying to take on the challenge of having courses in law and business and communications, becoming essentially training substrates for those professions by bringing in people to teach courses in those areas. On the other hand, it is useful to have those people around. People need role models. They need to see what they look like and rub elbows with them, establish network communications with them. So that's very useful. I think the level at which most programs adopt this presently is not so useful, having a career day, a career afternoon, where people come in, sometimes alums who want to be there, that are now in these other occupations, come in to give brief presentations and have a glass of wine with the students. That's not sufficient. Whether we want to mount actual courses in these areas, I think, is a bigger question. We have coursework in entrepreneurship, for example, that move people in directions of generating business plans, making proposals that could end up with startup companies. This is really using their current research as and their excitement about the possibilities of applying that work as a platform for learning some tricks of the trade in those areas. And whether that could extend to other areas as well, moving into scientific policy or law, I think it's an open question.
So maybe we just have 5 minutes left, and maybe what I'll let you do is just to kind of sum up and give you an open mic to hear your thoughts on implementation. So I think you made a strong case for the PhD hub, and the question is actually how to execute it. So if you were at the national level or local level, given carte blanche to execute a new plan to really make this happen, what would you do? And you're welcome to articulate any additional challenges that you see in executing your plan.
Well, I think that I would. I think that if we put out a challenge and raise opportunities for programs to be able to accept and embrace the world as it now exists, to be able to step back and rethink the way that we're doing our training, to adapt the training to things that will be of real-world use to our trainees, those programs will prosper and succeed, will be noticed, and will really make a difference. So I think that the key is providing support, is acknowledging this opportunity, and then providing support at the national level for programs across the country to invent ways to be able to do this effectively. And I think that that's going to be the key to implementation. It will be the success. Some of those programs will succeed really well. They will be noticed and they will have impact. And even faculty within those programs who may be still resistant, uncomfortable with this whole approach, thinking that their institution should be just training academic researchers and other places can do the other occupations, will have to acknowledge the fact that the programs are being successful, that their own students within those institutions are happier and more successful. So I think the key to implementation is support for small-scale experiments that can actually have that kind of impact.
So I'll just hop on the line real quick. This is Sarah Goodwin. I'm the director of iBiology, and I just wanted to thank you, Keith, for doing this hangout. I think that the ideas are excellent, and I think that you've given people a lot to think about. I want to do a quick promo for our next hangout, which will be on April 10th with Lydia Villakomaroff. Lydia Villakomaroff she's had a really amazing career. She was one of the key people who showed for the first time that bacteria could be induced to produce insulin. She's currently the chief scientific officer at Cytonome ST. She's one of the co-founders of SACNIS, and we're looking forward to welcoming her on April 10th.
Great.
And in closing, I can come here in person and thank my good buddy Keith. We appreciate your time and your thoughts, and I think more importantly, all the great things that you're doing for our scientific community.
Well, thanks, Ron. This whole hangout and iBio is a fantastic experiment that I think has real impact and something that we really need. So thank you, all of you, for setting this up and making it work.
Yeah, and I think the important thing is that we actually have a national and international conversation on these issues, because they're not trivial, they're important, and we need a lot of people to think about it deeply, both people at the senior level like Keith, and also critically a lot of young scientists who are really going to be the future of this profession.
Right.
So on that note, bye everyone. Stay tuned to iBiology and join us for the next conversations coming up on Google Hangout.
Great.
Thank you.